racialized slavery that is, because of course slavery is not new, and the enslavement of African peoples in the Americas is not by any means the beginning of slavery in human history. But that particular racialized slavery was justified on the grounds that Africans were not even human. In the early part of slavery, as it became racialized, it was, okay, they're the lowest breed of human, Europeans at the top, Asians and Arabs in the middle, Native Americans, Aborigines and Africans right at the bottom. And then eventually, actually, the propaganda or the idea of scientific racism, I mean, you can't really have such a thing as scientific racism, but pseudo-scientific racism, which was actually considered mainstream science in this country, in Germany, in America, got to such a point where it was actually publicly argued, actually, what black people are decided by someone. Someone decides what is and isn't on your curriculum. Why has someone decided it's more important for you to know that a king of England 500 years ago chopped two of his wife's heads off and divorced a couple others and then had beef with the Pope than it is for you to know that outside of Peterloo, outside of Manchester, a place called Peterloo in 1819, 15 unarmed protesters were hacked to death for demanding basic parliamentary reform? Because today when you have the right to vote in England, right, we know more about, actually, ironically, America's, black Americans' struggle for the right to vote than we do even about how regular people got the right to vote here in England. Because of course, in a way, people are trying to almost suggest that democracy is just the natural state of being in England. Our Prime Minister's telling us that there's this thing called British values, inherent, they've always been there, and they've always been exactly the same. Just always been democratic, always been about free speech. This is what British values are. But of course, when we examine our history, the history of Britain, like the history of many countries, is a history that's mad. And the Peterloo Massacre is one example of an incident in history. So when it comes to teaching the history of black people in Britain and black people in the globe generally, we have to actually start not in Britain, believe it or not. Because the misconception of African societies as they were when Europeans met them is so high. Because Tarzan and all these strange films and all this other propaganda that Africans were running around in the jungle chasing the lions and tigers and then Europeans turned up and civilized them. Because sadly, a lot of people still believe in that narrative, even if they're not being malicious. Because it's all they know. I have to have like a 5-10 minute preamble just so we get a sense of what were Africans living like in the 14 and 15 and 1600s when Europeans first travelled to Africa, so we can get a sense of the kinds of human beings that ended up in the Americas and eventually, in many cases, ended up here. And of course, I don't want to suggest that the first black people in this country came 500 years ago, so we'll go back to the start of black British history after we do a little bit of a preamble on medieval West Africa. So can I have the first slide, please? Does anyone know where this is? I know you know the name now, but where in Africa is this? Does anyone know? Good guess, it's not Nigeria, but good guess. This is the Congo. So it's the capital of what would have been the Congolese Empire at the time. It began Congo with a K. The city called Luanda, as you can see, the year is 1668. If I showed you a picture of London in this same period, it might not look remarkably different. In fact, London was not, in that period, planned city. So if you look at the streets of London, in an old map, they're wavy, they're bent, they go off in all kinds of directions. Even when you drive around central London today, you can still see that. Because unlike many modern cities, London was not planned, so you don't have straight streets and right angles and terraced housing in the way that you do here. So for a medieval city, this is a pretty advanced city to live in. It's clear evidence of urban planning. You don't just get terraced housing and straight streets and right angle roads by accident. Someone has to plan them. So this is a city called Luango, capital of the Congolese Empire in 1668. This is drawn by a Dutch man called Olfert Dapper, who visited Kingdom. Next slide, please. The largest empire in Western African history. Did anyone else think Timbuktu was a made-up place when they were young? Raise your hand if you thought Timbuktu wasn't a real place. Cool. So when I was young, I also thought I thought Narnia, Timbuktu. Same business. Now the reason why, this is why history is important, the reason why most of you still think that Timbuktu or thought that Timbuktu was a made-up place is because Timbuktu in the medieval world, in fact pre-medieval, in the 1300s and 14th century, Timbuktu was the richest state on earth. Not in Africa, on earth. This was the largest empire in Western African history. Spread all the way from what today would be Senegal, almost to the border of Chad, 1500 miles across the empire. The main king, the king who built this mosque, King Mansa Musa I, the most famous king to occupy the throne in medieval Mali, which is what the empire was called, the same as the country today. He travelled to Mecca on a pilgrimage in 1311, and he gave away so much gold when he was in Egypt that it took 10 years for the price of gold to return to normal. He's estimated by economists to be the richest person to have ever lived, adjusted for inflation. So significantly richer than Bill Gates, for example. They estimate that in modern terms he'd been worth about $400 billion. I don't know whether Bill Gates or Bill Gates or Bill Gates. So it gives you a sense of some of the wealth. Now, of course, when I was younger and a bit less critical, I thought, oh, wow, the richest guy in the world ever was from Africa. That doesn't necessarily pay me, fill me with honour or dignity anymore, because one guy being rich doesn't really mean anything. And it definitely doesn't tell us anything about whether the kingdom was just or unjust. But nonetheless, it gives you an indication of the state of civilization in Western Africa at the time. There were three main universities in the 12 and 1300s in the Empire of Mali. They were called this one here, Timbuktu. There was Sankore and there was Jene. Big universities where thousands of people studied year in, year out. There are 750,000 handwritten manuscripts surviving from that period in the empire that are only just being translated now. We recently got an English translation of one of the history books from there. This is Benin, Kingdom of Benin, which today would be in Nigeria. Same year, 1668, drawn by the same Dutchman that I showed you before, Olfert de Per. The wall, the Great Wall of Benin, can you see that this city has a wall like most medieval cities and medieval European cities? The Great Wall of Benin is a 1974 Guinness Book of World Records as the largest earthworks carried out prior to the mechanical era. Archaeologists have excavated it and they estimate that the wall would have been 10,000 miles, and I didn't make a mistake, I'll start, of walling in all at its height. It was destroyed actually when Britain invaded the Kingdom of Benin, which is how the Benin bronzes, has anyone seen the Benin bronzes before? Yeah. So the Benin bronzes, they're not actually bronze, they're copper, that's why they call them Benin bronzes. They're like life-size metal art, they're almost this big, casted, really sophisticated metal art from this period and from this kingdom. They are currently in the British Museum, that's how they got into the British Museum. So it's important that we understand the kinds of societies that existed there. And in fact, there is a potentially even larger monument in Nigeria. It's not really a monument, it's a moat. It's called Sumbo Eridan. It's still there today. It's 20 metres wide and 70 metres deep. And the kingdom that it was dug around is 400 square miles. Does anyone know how many square miles London is today? About 600. So it's like digging the M25 1,000 years ago. And it was about 1,000 years ago. Next slide, please. Last slide about pre-colonial Africa. This is what we call the head of the Oni, or female ruler of the Yoruba kingdom of Ile-Ife. Again, this is made from metal. This is a 700-800-year-old piece of art. Can you see that's a fairly sophisticated piece of art for 700-800 years ago? And there are tons and tons and tons of this kind of metal art that was made using what they call a lost wax technique. It's a very sophisticated technique. And of course, it involves melting metal and casting it into these kinds of beautiful shapes. Pseudo-scholars even tried to argue when they first found these masks in Yoruba land, just like with much other of African history, they say, oh, it couldn't have been Africans, actually, it must have been someone else. Chinese people, anyone but Africans must have done this. And then they invented a different myth. This is what's important about history. There was two races of black people, apparently, in Africa. There were Negroes and there were Hamites. And Hamites were black people that descended from white people. This was actually what scientists are arguing, right? And all of the civilization in Africa was the product of guess who? The Hamites, not the Negroes. So, and this spread all over Africa, they actually made this argument. First of all, they started with ancient Egypt. Because when the French discovered ancient Egypt in the late 1700s, immediately the three French scholars looked at the ancient Egyptian statue and were like, damn it, big African spreadings, what are we going to do? Because right? They recognised that their economy rested on the assumption of black inferiority, and that slavery was justified in that way. So Egyptology literally evolved from a couple men telling the truth, and then the rest of them dedicated to finding ways to explain away the African nature of ancient Egypt, and that's still with us today. If you watch Exodus, Gods and Kings, they're trying to convince you that Christian Bale represents what ancient Egyptians used to look like. Apparently they were Anglo-Saxon, right? So that kind of propaganda is still with us. Most of us think of the population of Egypt today, mostly light-skinned, mostly Arabic-looking, even though we know the periods in which they invaded and conquered Egypt, most of us still think that represents the ancient Egyptians. But that's a different lecture for another day. It's important to understand how it even comes, when it comes to Nigeria and other places in the continent, similar arguments at one point or other were levelled at all of these kingdoms I've just shown you. So, we have to understand, because my school teacher, I remember my school teacher said to me once, this is why we're still in something like Black History Month, she actually said to me, and this wasn't even the worst thing she said, but when Europeans got to Africa, they just didn't know black people were human. They just didn't know, you know, so you can't really blame them. When they got to China, they knew. And I was like, oh, yes, they didn't exactly treat the Chinese fantastically either, so it's not a good line of argument, right? So she was obviously trying to explain away her own bigotry and her own self-guilt. So it's important that we recognise what Europeans saw, what they said, what they observed, what they drew. And yes, some people lied, just like some people would lie when they're in Iraq, or Syria, or Libya, or any of the countries that we have a foreign policy relationship with today. Some people will go to these countries and say, man, everyone's dying. I went to Zimbabwe several times across the last few years. Great example of exactly that. Zimbabwe has tremendous problems, no doubt about it, but not compared to Jamaica. And everyone loves Jamaica, right? We have a far higher murder rate, we have a greater gap between rich and poor, we have far worse state repression. But as long as Jamaica keeps selling off its aluminium cheaply, no one's going to have an issue with Jamaica. So people's issue with Zimbabwe has nothing to do with human rights. Because if we had an issue with human rights, we'd have a problem with Brazil, or America, or many of the other countries that we consider perfectly good places to go on holiday, Jamaica included. So traveling to places, even today, you can see the gap between what you're told on the news and the propaganda and the reality of how people live in the place. And we could fast forward all the way to 1790. So we're talking about what Europeans knew. In 1790, there was something called the Parliamentary Select Committee on the Transatlantic Slave Trade. So this is where, basically, people were to present, people who'd explored or been traders in Africa, would come and tell the government, what have you seen? Wagwan down there, basically, right? How are people living? And if you read what the people actually said, they didn't say they're running around chasing lions and tigers with spears. They talked about the industry that was there. They talked about the level of civilization and technology that was there. They talked about the cities that were there. If you want some books on this subject, just to get a sense, you can try When We Rule by William Walker. You can try Everyday Life in an Early West African Empire, same author. Urban Heritage of West Africa, or African Towns and Cities Before the European Conquest. Just a couple intros to give you that sense. So it's important that we understand that the people that were kidnapped and went to the Americas very often were actually skilled workers. Because so many films have been made about slavery that we're convinced that all black people did was pick cotton during slavery. When we know for a fact, a skilled agricultural farmer, someone with knowledge of tropical farming, which of course Europeans didn't have, they'd never been to the tropics, was worth more money. We know someone that knew about mining was worth more money. Many of the people that were kidnapped, because they were involved in industries like this already, were skilled workers, were skilled labour. We also know that the vast majority of West Africans were inoculated against smallpox before they left Africa, with an African vaccination. So we talk about why did smallpox have such a terrible effect on Europeans and Native Americans and comparatively not affect Africans as bad. We now scientifically know why. Because they'd already dealt with it. We have observations of a guy travelling to Uganda, a Scottish doctor, observing a caesarean section performed successfully before he performed successfully anywhere in Europe. By successfully, I mean mother and child both staying alive. These are some of the things we can learn. So next slide, please. This all gives context to Black Britain. So when we talk about Black Britain, usually, and many of us who are of Caribbean origin, we are guilty of perpetuating this nonsense. We start the story in 1948. We act like there were no black people in Britain before 1948, and we all arrived on the Empire Windrush, and that's where the story starts. People in Liverpool especially should know that's nonsense, because Liverpool is one of the oldest black populations in the country, still surviving, right? But most of us, and like I said, my grand's family did come over on the Windrush, not in that particular boat, but it's part of that process. So us Caribbeans need to fix up and stop pretending that that's where the story starts. We could and should start the story. There's a fantastic book called Stay in Power by a scholar called Peter Fryer. It is by far the best book on black British history. It hasn't been surpassed in the 25 years since it was published. If you want an overview, just read that one book and you'll know yourself. He starts the story with the Roman occupation of Britain, the Roman colonisation of Britain, where the Libyan general Septimus Severus, who is still buried in York, and his troop of African troops are still buried up in York. You can go there near Hadrian's Wall. So we know that there were Africans in Britain before some of the people that consider themselves to be the English. So we need to be very careful when we get into this politics of who was here first, when you're on an island. Because we can all start a story at a different point in history and say, well, this person has more right to be in the country. Especially if your ancestors are German. You know, so it's very interesting, the politics of, this is my island. And I even hear children of immigrants coming with this nonsense. But if we fast forward a little bit, we can go to John Blank, who's on the Westminster Tournament Roll, musician, playing at Hampton Court. Paid musician, not a slave, paid musician. This is under the court of Henry VII. So early 1500s, there's a fantastic book called Blackamoors by a scholar called Onyeka, which looks at the role of black people in Tudor England. So we're going back 500 years now, right? We have, next slide please. We have a very interesting reference, several references to black people in Britain in Shakespeare's work. No one seems to want to deal with it. It's not very recent. I remember asking my teacher, Miss, why has Shakespeare got 15 poems to a black woman? If you read the poem, it's clear he's talking to a black woman. Scholars call her the Dark Lady. Shakespeare doesn't call her the Dark Lady. Shakespeare says, in the old age, black was not counted fair. Not dark, black. If it were, it bore not beauty's name. But now black is beauty's successive heir, and beauty slandered the bastard's shame. Blah, 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 you can read it. Right? Therefore, so he goes through, he's got 15 poems, Sonnet 127 to 142, are all to this woman they called the Dark Lady. And it's all very recently, of course, people who were ignorant of English history couldn't possibly have been a black woman. That would be so ridiculous. As if they were insulted by the idea that Shakespeare might have fallen in love with someone who was of African origin. Very recently, we've had even The Telegraph, many other newspapers cover the fact that they probably know who this woman was now. And originally it was thought she was someone else, because of course we just assumed it had to be a white person, so we looked at who we thought the white person could be. But it turns out it was probably a woman called Lucy Morgan from Clerkenwell, or Lucy Negro as they called her, right? And he has 15 poems to this woman. Moor used to be a generic term for a black person. So we could start a story there. That's Shakespeare's time. We could start a story in 1596, the 11th of July 1596 to be precise, when a merchant working on behalf of Queen Elizabeth I issued a proclamation asking for blackamoors, that was a generic term for black people, of whom there were already too many to be expelled from the kingdom. He wasn't successful, by the way. But the point is, it's evidence that there were already enough black people in London for it to cause an immigration problem in 1596. Next slide, please. So, of course, we have to have something to combat the cognitive dissonance, which was this idea, like I said, that Africans were less than human. But we have to ask ourselves anyway, let's run with that for a minute. Even if Africans were less than human, would we treat dogs that way? Probably not. And certainly not today. Yeah? So it's a very interesting, even that line of argument wouldn't even work anyway to someone who had compassion, but it did work. This is what Ibrahim looked like. Next slide, please. An Igbo of Eastern Nigeria. Next slide, please. This is the cover of his book printed at the time. It was actually a bestseller at the time, believe it or not. So it was a very popular book. I don't want to give you the impression it was underground. It was a big selling book. Very, very popular book. Next slide, please. William Davidson. Now, before we get to this gentleman, because he's a fascinating character, I want to tell you a little story. So, what also happened in the late 1700s in Britain? In 1731, the mayor of London passed a proclamation calling or making it illegal for black people living in London to earn a trade or a skill. So again, there must have been enough black people in London in 1731 to bother doing that. Why is that significant? Because 1731 is still significantly before many African Americans who fought for Britain in the American War of Independence, thousands of them in fact, were given their freedom in London. So we know, and thousands of people in that period of London's history would make a significant difference to the population. So thousands of men who fought for Britain in the American War of Independence, a war which Britain of course lost, were then taken to Nova Scotia in Canada and then brought to London, and then some of them were actually resettled in Sierra Leone. There's a book about that called Rough Crossings. The point is, thousands of African American men came to live in London, and we have all sorts of records of them living here. Of course, most of them married white women and bred into the British population. So there's probably a bag of people running around London today, some of whom probably very cool, but some of whom might even be bigots, who don't realise that just, you know, a couple of generations back, their great-great-great-great-great-grandma was with an African. So William Davidson, very fascinating character. Anyone heard this name before? Anyone ever heard this name before? Not one. Two. So William Davidson was part of an incident called the Cattle Street Conspiracy. So, remember I told you at the beginning about the Peterloo Massacre? This is how things all link up. So, in 1819, at Peterloo in Manchester, 15 unarmed protesters were hacked to death, working class people, for demanding basic parliamentary reform, a right to democratically participate in the country. In 1820, the following year, a government agent called George Edwards, this is actual, factual history, someone working on behalf of the government, infiltrated activist groups in London, and suggested to them that they should attempt to murder the government. The government agent did this. This is all fact, no one disputes this today. So this should give some colour to things that you learn about today, because history does repeat itself, right? So, this guy, George Edwards, infiltrates a group of which William Davidson was a part, yeah? So there's four or five of these brethren who are just on it. They're like, you know what, Peterloo is the final straw, class oppression in this country is too crazy, this sounds like a good idea, let's murk the government. So George Edwards gives them some information, he says, right, they're going to be at Grosvenor Square. Anyone been to Grosvenor Square down in London, where the American embassy is today?
Yeah.
So on that square there, he's like, right, they're having a meeting on this day, here's some guns, the government agent gives them all the guns, everything, hooks them up, basically sets them up. The day they're about to go and do the murder, police storm in, there's a big shootout, people are caught, police officers get shot. William Davidson and his cohorts become the last people to be publicly beheaded in Britain. In 1820, so not a million years ago, yeah. They were hung, Then they were beheaded, and then their bodies were dissolved in quicklime so their wives wouldn't be able to bury them. Yeah, so they were just disintegrated. Now, fair enough, I mean, they wanted to kill the whole government, right? But, nonetheless, it gives you a sense of the brutality of that period, eh? And it gives you a sense of how these people were dealt with, and it gives you a sense of how people were set up, of the level of political corruption. His mother was a Jamaican, an enslaved Jamaican woman, and his dad was the Attorney General of Jamaica, the British Attorney General. We don't need reminding the people on our money murdered slave masters. That's why we put them on the money. Because in the Caribbean, while abolitionists here were campaigning, our ancestors were getting busy chopping up slave masters and burning down plantations. And if you want to look at literally how you can see different abolition acts getting passed in relation to different rebellions, let's go through it. The Haitian Revolution in Haiti begins 1790s, ends in 1804. Haiti becomes independent in 1804, declares slavery illegal. Not only declares slavery illegal, declares that any African that reaches Haiti is free. Gives the money to Simon Bolivar to start the struggle in South America and only asks in return. Simon Bolivar was the man that liberated South America from Spanish rule. He was given money by independent African Haiti. And all they asked in return was that he set free the Africans when he set free those countries. They didn't ask for the money back, which is quite fascinating, right? Period of history, again, we don't know. Why is this important? Because Britain tried to crush the Haitian Revolution in the 1790s. But apparently in 1807, we just had a moral epiphany and said, oh, slavery's wrong. I'm tired of making all this money from slavery. Let's outlaw it now. Why now and why not at any other point before now? Haitian Revolution concludes in 1804. Britain abolishes the transatlantic trade in 1807. And where is Britain by 1807? Most of its sugar is being produced in India. It's lost America. In fact, the transatlantic trade is no longer a major part of Britain's economy in the same way that it was a generation before. And of course, the Haitian Revolution signaled the death knell for slavery anyway. When you have an independent black republic in the Caribbean, Haiti at the time was the most profitable colony in the world, by the way. So the whole of Europe has now lost the most profitable colony in the world. Lost by the French. The enslaved Africans defeated the French, the Spanish, and the British. And then declared the country independent. Right? But yet David Cameron doesn't know that 4 comes before 7. He keeps telling us Britain abolished slavery first. 1804 is before 1807. Basic arithmetic, right? So that's one way in which, or one major incident that shaped Britain's relationship with slavery. We fast forward, because Britain didn't abolish slavery in 1807. I don't know why we keep saying we did. We didn't. Transatlantic trade was abolished in theory in 1807. Of course, many British merchants continued to trade and profit and supply slaves to Portugal. Well, to Brazil, for the Portuguese, etc. Slavery was finally abolished in 1834. Why 1834? Why not some other year? Does anyone know? Why 1834?
Because of the uprising in Guyana. Coffee.
Guyana and Jamaica. The two largest uprisings in Caribbean history, or in British Caribbean, both occurred within 2 years of Britain finally saying, oh, this slavery thing is a bit long, you know. In Jamaica, 60,000 Africans organised themselves and basically burnt down the entire island. Burnt down half the plantations, killed people in response to Britain, hung 500 of them. But the point is, the infrastructure for slavery was basically destroyed. On top of the fact that Britain was now producing its sugar mostly in India, on top of the fact that America was now more in a position to compete in the transatlantic trade, becoming an emerging technical power with better ships than Britain, a whole host of reasons contributed to the abolition of slavery. We'd have to be completely stupid to believe this, because our elites suddenly said, yeah, it was probably wrong. Why so human beings? This is probably right. We'll just listen. But that's basically how I took the history. So the shaping of Britain's internal relationships with race and the shaping of Britain's internal economy was moved or had to move or adjust itself in relation to rebellions in its colonies. Does that make sense? And the change in nature of what was going on in its colonies. So when we read Peter Fryer's book, which I will recommend you should stay in power, he wrote another fantastic book called Black People in the British Empire. Because he understood very well that the relationship of black people in Britain was intimately tied to black people in the British Empire. And then to bring it up to date, of course, which is where we traditionally start the story, in the post-war era, in the 1940s, after people from Kenya and Zimbabwe, and of course 2.5 million volunteers from India and Jamaica and elsewhere had all fought for Britain. So Britain, just like the French, used their colonies to fight for them in World War II against the Nazis. World War II ends. Most of this was done on the promise that, you know, if you fight for us, we'll give you independence afterwards, and we'll treat you like humans, basically, if you come and fight and die for you. Of course, that isn't what happened. In the case of India, there were several violent uprisings in the years immediately following World War II. Because the Indians were like, hold on a minute, we just gave you 2.5 million people. We want our independence now. So within the 2 years till India got its independence in 1947, there were several periods of violent uprisings. In the Caribbean, there were labor strikes and unrest and all kinds of stuff.
found out, my mum swears a little bit, she went down the street, she went mad. I'm only bringing it to the personal because I think a lot of how this history, when we put history out there, it's a big thing called history, it's all academic. But we can bring it down to the personal. This teacher, this individual teacher, I had some very good teachers, I had some very bad ones. This particular woman is confronted, I grew up in an area of London called Camden. And Camden is very rich and very poor. So you have, I went to school with the St. Giles kids. I went to school with the head of groupies kids. I went to school with the guy whose dad designed the BMW Z3. But I also went to school with a lot of us who were on benefits and we didn't have no money, right? That's the kind of place Camden is, right? And so, even in that kind of multicultural place, you still have the legacies of some of these ideas that I've been talking about. The idea, particularly, that black people are academically less proficient. So what does my middle-class white female teacher do when confronted with a 7-year-old black boy on benefits who's top of the class? He's a bit talkative, you know. She can either encourage that person and say, you know what, I want you to get the best out of British society, you know, that's what this society is designed for. Or she can reinforce the class and race hierarchy of the society. Some of my teachers took the better option, some took the bad option. She was one of those that took the bad option. But I remember the day when my mum's white, right? My dad's black, so my mum comes down to school and confronts her, and I start swearing and going mad. Because I've been in this group for like 8 months at this point, almost the whole year, but I haven't read it, right? But because I can read good, my mum ain't noticed. It's only because another parent told her, you know, they've got your son in some group with the kids who can't speak English. And like I said, it's great that the school had that group for those kids, but clearly I can speak English, right? My mum marches down to school, she goes mad. And what was fascinating was the teacher's response. My mum has said nothing about race at this point. All my mum said was, why the F have you put my son in this group? Are you taking the F and piss or whatever it is your mum said? Unfortunately, yes, mum, sorry, I'm grassing that. We did swear upon it. But she was legitimately angry. My mum was a stickler for education. And the teacher went, I admit to doing it. She hit me as well, right? She hit me with a book and a leader, right?
So, the teacher?
Yeah, the teacher, yeah. Wow. My mum, I mean, my mum hit me. But this is the teaching. So my mum's confronted about all this stuff, and this is why I think it's fascinating. Because my mum, as I said, it's important that my mum's white in this context because of the teacher's response, and because my mum hasn't mentioned anything to do with race. And the teacher immediately goes to mum, I admit to hitting him and putting him in the group, but it's not because he's, and she's about to say coloured, right? She goes, and she realises, I'm not really supposed to say coloured anymore, am I? Damn, I remember like the dilemma on her face, right? And then she wants to say black neither, and she's like, because he's brown. She finally arrived at what she thought was an accurate description. And she looking back, now I feel very sorry for her, you know, in concluding all of this history. I feel very sorry for a person whose belief in their own ethnic exceptionalism was so strong that they could find an intelligent 7-year-old a problem. Teachers would say I was aggressive when I was 6. How the hell can a 6-year-old be aggressive? I still hear teachers saying the same stupid stuff today. Of course, they only say it about poor kids. I've never been to a rich private school, which I taught many, and someone says a 6-year-old is aggressive. Again, I don't want to pretend this only happens on grounds of race. I'm sure there's some pretty tough schools in Liverpool where teachers are like, ah, this kid's aggressive. He's 6. A 6-year-old can't be aggressive. I don't care what anyone wants to tell me. It's not possible. You're 6. Sit down, or I'll sit you down. And it won't take much. You sit a 6-year-old down, and they'll start crying. But this legacy is ruined. So I think in terms of interpreting black history today, what is the challenge? Black history in Britain has to be, A, placed in the context, as I gave you at the beginning, of the types of societies that existed in pre-colonial Africa. Otherwise, we get this mythological idea that, you know, black people were in a Tarzan movie and then they were enslaved in the Caribbean. And we get all kinds of justifications that benefited from slavery. BBC did a documentary last year and Channel 4 saying that that's why Jamaicans win the Sprint because of slavery. You know, did anyone see that stuff? No? Someone must have seen it because they put one of them before the 200 metres final. Literally right before the final, they were like, oh, by the way, in case you thought black guys are just fast because they train hard and they're disciplined, they're all fast because of slavery. Of course, there are people in Jamaica who've never been slaves, who got off the boat in 1653 from the Spanish, caught a couple of Spanish men and ran in the hills and they've been there ever since. How do we know the same Bolt's family is not from that group? Of course, slavery lasted a century longer in Brazil than it did in Jamaica. There are 80 million black people in Brazil today, 2 million in Jamaica, so 40 times more black people in Brazil than there is in Jamaica. So if slavery is what makes people good at sprinting, Brazil should win all the time, right? But this kind of idiotic, unscientific, eugenics-inspired idea is still with us because of some of this history. And when we have this debate, as we've been having the whole last 2 years, around the election and everything else, about immigration, it's couched in this, some people belong, some people don't belong. How many people knew, Liverpool particularly should know this, that after World War II, many Eastern Europeans also came here? Not a lot of people knew that, because Poland was a British ally, right? Yeah. So many white people today, saying, this is my country, I belong here, blah, blah, blah. Your parents came over from Poland, the same time my grandparents came from Jamaica. Make up your mind. And I've even seen Asian and black kids talking about, they probably should come in here, they shouldn't be here. And I'm looking at them dumbfounded, like, you've got to be shitting. You have to be kidding, right? So this legacy of racism is still with us, and I think an accurate history doesn't have to be romantic. It doesn't have to be made up. History's tough. Horrible stuff happens in history.
Find its reason.